So, as a sort of lighter introduction to slit ventricle syndrome, it is like the ventricular system is telling the V patient, I love you, but I hate you. You understood now what I meant?
Yes,
I
sir.
love you, but I hate you. There is a famous, I think, song
Yes, sir.
which says, I hate you,
Hello.
but I love you. And I hate that I love you. That's what that lady sings.
That is an English song.
English song, yes. That may be copied into Bollywood. I'm not sure. So anyway, digression apart, it is basically functional shunt failure, slit ventricular syndrome. Generally occurs with conventional VP shunts and generally occurs due to years of overdrainage, ICP becomes very, very low in the upright position. So these people develop what is called as postural headache and nausea, and it is also defined as a severe life-modifying headaches and chronic intermittent headache with nausea, vomiting, and altered mental status. And if you check the reservoir, it will fill slowly and after you compress and empty the reservoir. The milder forms are seen in adults, whereas the severer forms, unfortunately, are seen in children. The pathology is due to intermittent ventricular isolation, overdrainage of a one side ventricle, which collapses and occludes the shunt and impedes the flow of CSF, causing intermittent intracranial hypertension. Or it can also be due to a non-compliant ventricular system with periventricular soft tissue gliosis or a stiff wall of the ventricle. And they say that overdrainage can also lead to decreased cerebral compliance. And there is a capillary absorption laziness, which is described in these children. So they are less able to absorb the variations in the ventricular fluid pressure.
Sir, 2 minutes up, sir.
It's also called as container-contained mismatch. Yeah, go ahead.
Sir, the incidence is reported variedly from 1% to some studies showing as high as 37%.
Okay.
So in this,
The one I read, it said 3 to 5% of all V patients.
yes, sir. And this
Okay.
cannot be diagnosed exclusively on neuroimaging. So there, Ricarte has introduced a triad. This is called Ricarte's triad, which consists of intermittent headache lasting for 10 to 30 minutes, and small size cerebral ventricles on neuroimaging, and slow or non-filling of CSF shunt reservoir. When all three are
Okay.
seen, it's mostly slit ventricle syndrome. And
Okay.
symptoms include chronic headache, nausea, vomiting, drowsiness, lethargy. It can regress spontaneously or after administration of an anti-edema measures. And the pathophysiology, as discussed, is intermittent occlusion of intraventricular catheter by walls of the collapsed ventricle There
that
are
leads
five
to.
such possible causes, sir. One is the intracranial hypotension, which they say when the child is in the recumbent position, then the intracranial tension is normal. But when the child is in the erect position, especially as the day progresses, the intracranial pressure increases. This is one possible cause. And for this, they say the regular device that retards siphoning, DRS device, is better. So the later shunts are prevents slit ventricle syndrome is what this one possible cause. The other possible cause is intermittent proximal obstructions because of the older types of shunts. Because of sudden drainage of CSF, there is collapse of the ventricle, which causes partial obstruction of the shunt. And gradually, as the day progresses, the shunt starts draining. So
Okay.
this also is better treated by DRS, is what they say, sir. And
Okay,
sir,
so treatment is treatment. Go to treatment now, quickly.
treatment is mostly prevention, sir. That is, we have to use programmable pressure valves or shunts added with an antipsychotic.
Yes, correct, correct,
When it comes
correct.
to treating the diagnosed case of slit ventricle,
Like I told, some might spontaneously regress, or we have to revise the shunt using either a programmable pressure valve or adding an anti-cyclone device, or subtemporal decompression by craniectomy is told, bitemporal enlarging craniotomy, and other options are.
Yeah, those are all older treatments which are now given up.
Yes, sir.
So, you're right. You use as Vinay mentioned, anti-siphoning device. And now programmable valve shunts are also being used, where you can adjust the pressure of the intraventricular catheter.
Yes.
And then some people have also tried conversion to thicoperitoneal shunts.
Okay.
That's also been tried.
Yes, and there is some shunt removal protocols. So which,
yes, correct.
Which people follow in, and first of all, diagnosing these patients is a thing where first, based on the triad, then they will go ahead with the MRI scan to see the size of the ventricle. And in patients who have severe, what you call, like in children who are not unable to attend school, or in adults who are unable to attend their work properly, in such patients, they follow this shunt removal protocol, where the patient is admitted and then the shunt is removed, and an extracranial device is placed, and a pressure of about 25 centimeters of water is kept, and we see whether the ventricles enlarge in size or whether the symptoms improve or worsen. If the symptoms worsen, then they introduce a shunt. But if the symptoms remain like that, then they put a endoscopic third ventricle. Then they do an endoscopic third ventriculostomy.
Yeah. ETV is a very important treatment modality for this. ETV is an important treatment modality. And some neurosurgeons are able to dilate the ventricles to do an endoscopic third ventriculostomy.
Yes.
They're able to do it
in
spite of the ventricle being slit.
Yes, sir. In some this one, there is also shunt failure, but ventricle are not enlarged. In that situation, it is probably because it is causing something like a pseudo tumor cerebri, where the vessels are the sinuses are blocked, the pressures are high in the sinuses. In such cases, they might need lumboperitoneal shunts.
Yes. Another one is a special shunt which is configured for these patients, which is called as a ventriculocisternoperitoneal shunt, where there are two ends, one in the ventricle, other one is the in the cistern, and both the ends and draining into the peritoneum.
Yes.
I never knew about so many of these treatments because I hardly ever treat hydrocephalus. Ramesh must be having a lot of information.
Dr. Ram, can I say something?
Very many
Ramesh?
Yes, sir. If we are, in case we get it, actually we involve a neurosurgeon and send them.
Yeah. Yeah.
So,
yeah.
We don't
Dr. Ram,
really
can I say something?
Hands-on experience on slit ventricle, sir.
Okay.
Robert.
Yeah, please go ahead, Robert.
Ramesh, can I hear? Can you hear me?
Please, please tell me.
Yeah.
No, Robert wanted to say something.
Just one comment, because we've seen quite a few slit ventricles when I used to do them in St. John's and thing. Practically, if at all you end up having to revise a shunt, you know, and it's usually they come in quite an emergent situation. The biggest danger is when we pull out the ventricular catheter to put a fresh one in, it's very hard to get back into the ventricle.
Very true.
It's very hard to get back into the ventricle. So, one thing which Dr. Bajpayee used to insist was that before you pull it out, when you've diagnosed it before, is to fill up saline into that ventricle through that existing ventricular catheter.
Yeah. Correct.
Pull it out and very quickly go in. And if you're not able to cannulate it, abandon the procedure.
Oh.
And come back when the ventricle is filled up naturally. Because I've seen a child lose function because of repeated neural punctures trying to find that slit ventricle.
Yes, correct.
Yes.
It's mainly right.
Yes. Thanks, Robert.
Sir, time up, sir. 5 minutes.
Yeah, we'll go to the next one.
Yes, sir.
Infratil lesion.
Yes,
so
sir.
I won't talk much about this because just basically a list of conditions leave you guys. I will just mention that there are things which we need to keep in mind, that there are obstructive lesions which need to be tackled in an emergency. There are obstructive lesions which cause obstruction of two systems, and what looks like a benign cyst on the outside in an intraorbital site may indicate a sinister problem occurring inside. So these three things you please please list the conditions, and please quickly tell about the conditions and their treatment. Don't go into various things. Conditions. List the conditions. Interlabial masses. Go ahead. Start.
Sir, paraurethral cyst, Gartner's duct cyst.
Okay.
Then
paraurethral cyst can be due to which duct gland?
Periurethral glands of
duct gland. What's the name of the
periurethral glands of skin?
Hello.
Okay. Right. Yeah. I can hear. Go ahead.
Imperforate hymen.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Hymen.
Yes.
And seco ureteroseal most commonly in girls due to duplex system. Hello.
More than seco ureteroseal, it can prolapse.
So can you repeat that? Network connect mode.
Sir, you're not audible.
Seco ureteroseal is a link. Okay. Now, am I audible now?
Yes, sir. Better, sir.
Okay. Is it better now?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Okay.
Sir,
see, when you have a prolapsed ureteroseal, to just give me 30 seconds, I will switch over to. I'm on a wireless this thing device, so I'll just switch over. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Sorry. Is it clear what I am speaking?
Yes, sir. It's clear, sir.
Okay. Now, you said seco ureteroseal. Seco ureteroseal is not that common compared to a prolapsed ectopic ureteroseal.
Yes.
Okay. There's a difference between seco ureteroseal and prolapsed ectopic ureteroseal. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So in prolapsed ectopic ureteroseal, which is more common as a mass, 90% are from the upper moiety of a duplex ureter, and 10% are from a single system. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Then
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Okay, both of them can cause obstruction to the urinary bladder and needs to be treated urgently either by, if possible, to catheterize the bladder or by puncturing the urethral seal.
Okay.
Okay, go ahead. Tell other.
Sir, urethral polyp, prolapsed urethral fossa, annular skin tag, botryoid aramis.
Yeah, sarcoma botryoid. Yes.
Hydrocolpus.
Hydrocolpus and hematometrocolpus. Okay.
Condyloma acuminatus.
What is that?
The condyloma.
Condyloma acuminatus.
Okay, that is very, very rare, I guess. Anyway, maybe in adolescent in Western countries. So, important thing to remember is that things which are sinister, like, you know, as you said, hydrometrocolpus or hematometrocolpus obstructs the
both urinary systems, sir.
Obstructs the Mullerian, the vagina and the uterus, as well as the bladder.
Bladder.
Both it can obstruct. Okay?
Yes.
And the uretrocele can, prolapsing uretrocele can obstruct the bladder.
Yes.
Okay. Now I said, what looks benign outside can indicate something sinister inside. What is that? Are you guys hearing what I am talking?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Go ahead.
Sir, is it a botryoid RMS?
Botryoid RMS? No, it everyone knows, no? A pediatric surgeon will know that this is sinister.
Gartner's ductus.
Ah, correct. Now you are talking. What does it indicate?
Ectopic ureter.
It can indicate an ectopic ureter, and also it can indicate a
unilateral renal agenesis, sir.
Unilateral renal agenesis. Very good, Meenakshi. Thank you. Thank you.
So one more thing, endodermal sinus.
Endodermal sinus tumor is yeah. It can present. And sometimes some people will, some girls will have very hypertrophied hymenal skin tags that can also present. Urethral prolapse is very unique to African American children, which we see in the US. And generally, it is diagnosed where, you know, it is common. If it is not common, it is very difficult to diagnose. So you will have to examine the child under anesthesia, and then you have to see the two orifices and then diagnose a urethral mucosal prolapse.
Hemangioma
is possible. Yes.
We recently.
Now, when there is a imperforate hymen, what do you do for that? Like a uretrocele, you cannot puncture it. If you puncture it, what will happen?
High chance that it will again reunite.
No, one is, you know, sort of temporarily you can decompress, but you'll be introducing infection. Yeah, which can be life-threatening in this children. Okay. So what's the treatment for imperforate hymen? Treatment for imperforate hymen.
Cruciate incision and suturing the mucosa and outward.
No, you have to excise the hymen. So the technique to excise the hymen is to put a cruciate incision and then excise all the four quadrants. And then put a running absorbable suture.
Yes.
Why is everybody very silent? I thought you guys will jump on me with this, you know, so-called introital tumor.
Yes.
So generally, when you have a imperforate hymen and or a low transverse vaginal septum, then you will have a mass at the introitus as well as a pelvi-abdominal mass.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. That is a characteristic feature.
Yes.
Now, what is Ohira syndrome? I am probably tongue twisted. Oh, Vera syndrome. Obstructed hemivagina and
ipsilateral renal anomaly.
Ipsilateral renal anomaly. Correct. Very good. Excellent. Generally, this does not present as a introital lesion, but it can present as a obstructed vagina, which can compress on the bladder, and the bladder can get obstructive uropathy due to chronic obstruction of the bladder.
Yes.
Anything else you want to add?
No, sir.
Okay.
We'll go to the next one, sir.
Okay, sure.
Yes, we can start.
Okay, torticollis is also called as wry neck or a twisted neck. So commonest
sir, hello.
1/3 of the sternocleidomastoid, and it can be also due to a tight sternocleidomastoid muscle with limitation of passive this thing. So important thing is to remember that this is not seen at birth. It is usually seen at 2 to 4 weeks of age. Very often seen at first visit to the hospital in a well baby clinic, because most of these babies are usually having no other anomalies. So it is due to some sort of a perinatal insult which occurs due to delivery or some intrauterine problem. But most of them will be breech babies and would have instrumental delivery of the aftercoming head. That is very commonly seen. The pathology is endomysial fibrosis with deposition of collagen and fibroblasts around the muscle tissue, which causes muscle atrophy. So normal neck rotation should be about 120 degrees arc. So it has to go little bit past the shoulder. Anything which is limiting more than 10 degrees less than normal is considered as indication for treatment with initially passive stretching exercises. And then if that doesn't work, then you have to go for surgery. 91 to 95% of them will respond to passive stretching exercises and physiotherapy, and a few of them will require surgery, which consists of division of the sternomastoid tumors through various approaches.
Sir, 2 minutes up, sir.
Yeah. One important point is hemifacial hypoplasia and plagiocephaly. These are two things we must remember. Okay, go ahead. Discuss.
So, the incidence is described to be about 0.4% of all live births, sir. With the right side...
0.4%. Okay.
0.4%. And with the right side being affected more than the left, about 60%. And bilateral is seen in about 2 to 8% cases.
Very good. Excellent. Okay. Go ahead.
And we already discussed the etiology, sir, with the intrauterine embryopathy or ill positional disorders leading to a sort of compartment syndrome in utero. Or with 60% of them are associated with these obstetric difficulties, as you mentioned, sir. And there's also concomitant congenital hip dysplasia seen in most of these cases.
Excellent point. And also they will have talipes also, some of them.
Yes, sir.
And metatarsus adductus. To indicate that there is either crowding or less amniotic fluid in these children.
Yes.
Okay, go ahead.
Clinically, it is palpable along the sternocleidomastoid as a hard, discrete, spindle-shaped cell with a swelling, which is painless, measuring about 1 to 3 centimeter, and it is palpable within the sternocleidomastoid. And head is classically rotated to the opposite side with slight flexion of the head towards the affected side.
So flexion is towards the affected side, and the chin always points to the opposite side. Yes.
In older children, it may not be seen as classically, as they have some compensatory measures. They have some restricted rotation and lateral flexion, and the shoulder is elevated to compensate to keep the eyes in a straight line.
Yes. So important to remember the visual axis is, will get affected in these children.
Sir, actually what happens is in torticolis, sir, the vascular inset, vascular neurovascular inset will occur, supplying the sternocleidomastoid during birth, sir, because of breech presentation or during trauma. So what happens was the sternocleidomastoid supplying muscles, the superior in the middle and inferior part of the supply, the superior thyroid artery and external thyroid artery supplying it, then during that inset might occur and causing straining. So commonly,
okay,
you can classify torticollis as dynamic and adynamic, sir. So in dynamic again, we have congenital muscular torticollis, and this is most common we see congenital muscular torticollis. We have to differentiate from the other also, like osseous torticollis, central nervous system torticollis, peripheral nervous torticollis, ocular torticollis, and non-muscular soft tissue torticollis. So when we come to this dynamic congenital muscular torticollis, it is the most common we see. So in this, we see that there is three types, so that is tumor, sternomuscular tumor, sternomuscular muscular which is thickened, and one is postural. So it is the tumor is most common, which is early seen in 6 weeks. The second one is muscular part, which is seen in 16 weeks, and the postural, which is seen in 20 weeks. The treatment, what we commonly see is tumors, and it is not generally subside, but if you give passive treatment for almost 6 months, if it doesn't subside, then we need to go for surgery. The muscular part, we can give conservative, if it doesn't subside, we go for surgery. The postural doesn't need surgery at all, because it is only the thin muscular thin, it can be with passive exercise, we can reduce it. So when we come to the associated disorder, as you mentioned that along with plagiocephaly, ipsilateral facial hemiapoplasia will be there. And sir, on examination, we see that same thing. We see that shoulder will be pushed up, shoulder right side, ipsilateral shoulder is pushed up, and trapezial muscle is lost. And so in radiological evaluation, commonly we see radiological evaluation. So commonly X-ray doesn't give much information, but ultrasound we can see sternocleidomastoid muscle tumor or any thickened muscle we can see. And CT,
okay,
rule out for other posterior fossa tumors, so commonly what we see.
Okay. What is the differential diagnosis? Differential diagnosis.
Sir,
lots of differential diagnosis are there.
Yes, sir, lots of are there, sir. In this
torticollis, okay,
in this osseous torticollis, congenital traumatic inflammatory, we can see the clipped fail syndrome. If there is fusion of the vertebra will be seen, and traumatic cervical vertebral fracture will be seen, sir. And axial subluxation will be seen. So, if
some children will have absence of sternocleidomastoid unilaterally.
Mm-hmm.
It's a congenital absence of sternocleidomastoid.
So, we should rule out also postural.
What is Sandifer syndrome?
Sir, it's a gastroesophageal reflex disease with torticollis, postural disease.
Yeah. And
it's basically
a peculiar
contorturing of the neck when eating.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
It
yes,
is not a
correct,
permanent one.
Yes. Especially after eating, they get it. Yeah. To prevent the reflux from occurring.
Yes, sir.
Which is seen in a very few children with the severe GRD.
Yes.
Then you have Chiari type 2 malformation. Then ocular torticollis due to fourth cranial nerve palsy.
Yes, sir.
Then you have something called as a pterygium coli, which is due to the fascia of the neck being sort of tightened. And very rarely you will have unilateral lambdoid or coronal craniosynostosis, which causes plagiocephaly.
Yes, sir.
Okay. A few things I wanted
to
add.
I wanted to add a few things, sir. Yeah.
So, one, previously it used to be thought of because of trauma. But later on, there has been enough evidence to say it is not necessarily trauma, it's a myofasciitis, which actually causes a swelling. And when it heals with fibrosis. So, we need to do physiotherapy when there is an active tumor so that it doesn't go into contracture. One.
Yes.
Some people used to give steroids. I think Vellore group used to give a steroid injection, but I really don't believe in it because whether you give steroids or not, it is going to heal anyway.
Yes, correct.
Third, whenever you get a child, basically you see for a history of sternomastoid tumor. That's what generally we see these days. And it heals with the torticollis is another matter. Whereas if you see an older child with a torticollis without a proper history, then is the time where you have to keep your antenna up and look for other things. For example, cervical bone anomalies, ipsilateral hemivertebra, fusion, atlanto axial dislocation, all those things.
Very good, excellent. All very pertinent points.
And ocular torticollis is because of, they say, it's because of improper ocular fixation. That is, all of us tend to have an equal distance between the two eyes because that is how it is fixed. Some children may have a little twisted and they may get it, but I've never seen one. Then again, for treatment, initially it's better to avoid getting into the surgical necessity by giving adequate physiotherapy. In fact, yes, what is most important during physiotherapy is not to be rigorous. In fact, one important key point when you're giving a physiotherapy is to make sure that the other person holds the shoulder down. Because if you don't hold the shoulder down, movement of the neck can be compensated by the movement of the shoulder and the physiotherapy may be ineffective. Physiotherapy will fail. Second thing is, when you're doing a physiotherapy, tell the parents not to be very vigorous and not to go against the child's neck movements. It has to be along with the neck movements, the gentle physiotherapy. So sometimes what they tell them is to just get the baby's shoulder up to the edge of the cot or the table and just allow the head to extend backwards and to gently rotate. This is a simple method which you can do.
Excellent.
That's it.
Okay, third year's surgery. Types of surgery. Quickly.
Most common.
Yeah, you said division. What do you divide?
Sternum. Is it sufficient?
Sir, we need to cut to the deep cervical dissection.
So sternocleidomastoid and trapezius also will be taught tightness. That also has to be divided.
So basically, what you need to do is to release both the heads of sternocleidomastoid along with all the fascia and what other muscles it is there. So it is better to drape in such a way that the head can be moved to make sure that the sort of mastoid process touches the opposite shoulder. Okay. To that extent, you have to release so that the sternocleidomastoid is put to full stretch.
The fascia has to be released up to midline and up to the trapezius. Important thing to remember is the spinal accessory nerve and the brachial plexus. Anyway, if you stay just at the fascia, you will not cause any injury. Yes. What is the newer treatment for this?
Endoscopic sternotomy.
What is that?
Stealth. Endoscopic.
Stealth surgery. Yeah. So how do you do it?
Transaxillary approach.
Transaxillary approach. Yes. I think Dr. Ramesh has done quite a few of that.
Yes, sir. They have seen it too. And other thing is, have any idea about what our orthopedics do?
They do bipolar releases. They position as well as the insertion, both they release.
Somehow I'm not too happy, sir. Is it? I don't think it is necessary because if you release at one end, it should be all right. I don't see any reason why they have to release it.
Correct.
But they believe in it.
Yeah. See, one of the things with the either end release is that you maintain the contour of the neck. If you release the sternomastoid at the middle point, which many of us used to do, the contour of the neck may not remain normal. So, cosmetically, it may be a sort of a inadequate or a bad operation, if you look at it that way.
I don't know, maybe
the sternomastoid will fuse back and it will look normal. I don't know. But I feel
But I think none of them work, sir. It is better to release the whole thing. Only thing if you do it in a female patient, they can't act in TV serials because they can't really cry with both the sternomastoid going up.
Yes. And other important thing is when you do this surgery, the release surgery, to have the physiotherapy department involved in the care of this child. And they probably use some orthosis for these patients, like a helmet with a cervical brace or something, and which they usually wear during the day and remove it during the night or something like that. And the physiotherapist will get actively involved in the treatment of this child with various exercises and all that. So important to get physiotherapy.
What we used to do in Bombay was, we used to measure the collar, cervical collar. When the child is there, preoperatively we used to measure in such a way that the one which is sort of short, reverse it, measure the opposite side, so that postoperatively you can put it in such a way that the sternum mastoid remains extended.
correct, correct.
But I really don't know if it is really that much aggressively required. If you can just passively stretch the neck, it should be sufficient, sir.
Yeah, yeah.
Sir, do some people do even bilateral release for unilateral torticollis, sir?
I don't know.
Not heard of it.
Okay.
Not heard of it.
Yes.
No, sir, it is not bilateral, it's a bipolar from the attachment in the condyle and the manubrium area.
Yeah.
Sir, yeah, but don't they? I've seen some general surgeons do the other side, not the ipsilateral affected side. They release it opposite side thinking that is the cause of problem.
Oh, okay, okay.
Sir,
like the, you know. Sir? Old-time Greek physicians, how they used to do for something.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Robert, anything you need to, you want to add?
No, sir. No.
Okay.
Sir,
I've seen one hemivertebra. I've seen like hemivertebra also associated with the torticollis. But I don't think we should do routine x-rays.
Okay. Yeah, I also don't do
talk
routine
about
x-rays.
Yeah, to talk about bilateral, I think the bilateral comes in for the physiotherapy, wherein we teach them to also stretch the other side just for, so that completeness, rather than only the affected side.
Okay, okay. Right.
So, role of botulinum
toxin?
No, it is completely discredited now. Nobody uses botulinum toxin. There is no literature support in pediatric literature.
Yes.
Even the physiotherapy literature says it should not be used. Botulinum toxate should not be used.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
You're done?
Okay. It is,
thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.